Good morning. Whew, I got to tell you, after that, thank you, worship team. I know you're scattered at the moment, but thank you, guys. That was just, I love being led into the Lord's presence like that, and you did it so faithfully this morning. Thank you for it. And I want to thank you guys, too. Last weekend, Amy and I felt so warmly welcomed, and I know we haven't met you all yet, and we will, but we just felt so loved already for just our first weekend here. I don't officially even work for the church yet, but you guys have welcomed us so faithfully and so lovingly. Thank you for it. And forgive me if you come up to me today or in a month when we actually get here and I don't remember your names. It's not intentional at all. I'm working hard, but please forgive me in that. And we just can't wait to get here. We'll be here. I don't know if we shared this last week, but my official start date is May 30th, so we will be back then. Our kids will be with us. We have two college aides, a son and a daughter at Taylor University, and our 90-pound lab as well. We have a black lab retriever. We'll all be here in May, so we cannot wait to get here. But enough of that. Go ahead and grab your Bibles, open them up, or swipe your screens, whatever you prefer. To Ephesians chapter 3, we're going to continue building on what Dr. Rodelnik has just so well unpacked already for us. We're going to continue on what he's been doing here in Ephesians chapter 3. As you turn to that, I want to ask you to think on something or chew on something for a second. Have you ever in your life had a secret or a mystery revealed to you that just kind of blew your mind? Maybe you have, maybe you haven't, but something that when you found it out, it changed your perspective on something entirely. Maybe it changed your life. Maybe it changed your understanding. Has anything ever been revealed to you? Like, you know, I think back in my life, when I was thinking of this, the first thing that came to mind for me was the summer of 1982, and I'm sitting in a movie theater, and Darth Vader says, "Luke, I am your father." And as a 12-year-old kid, like my world was rocked, and I had to wait 3 years to figure out if it was true, right? But I was thinking more on this, and I remember part of my story is that I'm adopted. When I was a baby, I was 3 months old, I was adopted. And in high school, I found my birth parents. And it's more to that story, and it's a beautiful story, and I'll tell you more someday. But we were part of an organization here in Chicago called Yesterday's Children back in the 80s and 90s. And they would host conferences for adoptees and adoptive parents and birth parents. And my brother and I, who he was also adopted, also found his birth parents, every year we were asked to share our story because it was unique and it was really a special one. And I remember sitting at one of these conferences, and this just had gotten done sharing. I'm 16 years old. And this 27, 28-year-old man comes up to me just weeping and sobbing. And I was like, "Hey, what, you know, can I help you with anything?" He's like, "Just, you know, thank you for sharing your story and all." He goes, "I'm 28. My parents passed away a year ago. And my uncle just told me last month that I was adopted." 28 years this guy has been living, thinking, these are my biological parents. This is the only family I have, and they're now gone. And then he finds out he's adopted. I mean, on so many levels, right? His mind is blown. Like, why was this secret kept from me? Wait, I have a biological family I can get to know. But I just, like, I think of that kind of a mystery, something that is so earth-shattering and mind-blowing that it changes everything. Well, Paul does that here in his letter to the Ephesians. He talks about a mystery that was in his lifetime made known. It's not necessarily new to us. But they were the first generation to know this mystery that God, in his wisdom and his sovereignty, had kept for thousands of years, but would now become made known. So let's look at this. Ephesians chapter 3, follow along with me, starting in verse 1. "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. Paul is explaining this mystery that for ages God has kept quiet. God has kept a secret. In fact, Jewish people up until this time, right, thought they were the chosen people of God, that unless you were Jewish, you're up a creek without a paddle, right? We are the only people of God. But now through Paul and the apostles, God would reveal, I've had this other plan all along, and now you're going to know about it. That the gospel isn't just for you Jews, though, and though even many of you have rejected it, and I'm not changing my mind, this was my plan all along. The gospel isn't just for you. I'm revealing it to you now, the simple fact that the gospel is for everyone. Yes, it's for you Jews, but it's also for you Gentiles. And for these Jewish believers, for Paul, who was trained as a Pharisee, this was mind-blowing. I mean, his own salvation was mind-blowing for Paul, right? But this was mind-blowing. I don't know if you've ever been to a gender reveal party. These are something that's been happening in the last handful of years, right? If you haven't heard of them, it's when a young couple becomes pregnant and they want to reveal the sex of their child, boy or girl, in a very fun way. They have a big party and somebody there knows. Somebody there knows the sex of the baby. Maybe it's a sibling, like a sister or brother. Maybe it's a mom or dad. But they've created a creative way, whether it's a balloon with colored pink or blue confetti, or you can get these confetti cannons that have pink or blue confetti or dust. And at a certain moment in the party, you pop that balloon and everybody finds out, right? One person knew the mystery and now everybody knows the mystery. I was watching one of these online this week, in fact. It was quite hilarious in my opinion. The couple came together to pop this big balloon that was full of either pink or blue confetti. And as they went to pop it, it didn't pop and it slipped out of their hands. And it was, I think, somehow unfortunately filled with helium. And it just floated away. So at least in that moment, they didn't find out what their child was. But it's that same idea, right, that somebody at the party knew, and now everybody knows. And now everybody's going to go tell everybody. This was what was happening in the moment. Paul and the apostles had learned this mystery. Right? Look back at verse 6 with me, right? This again is the mystery. The mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Paul's saying that Gentiles are equal to us, equal with us. We are one in the same. There's no difference. There's no hierarchy. We are one in the same before the Lord. The gospel isn't just for Jewish people. It's for everybody. Now, if there were any Jewish readers of this or learners of this, a Gentile could mean enemy, could mean a people that you hate, could mean your oppressors. But Gentile, on the most simple level, means unbeliever. Prior to knowing Christ, I hate to break this bad news to you, but prior to knowing Christ, you were a Gentile. We were all Gentiles, unless you actually had grown up Jewish and become a Christian, but we were all Gentiles because we were simply unbelievers. The idea that Paul is getting at is simply this. Here's your big idea for this morning. This mystery was made known to some so the gospel would be made known to all. In this time in history, God chose to reveal this mystery to Paul and the apostles. Why? Because of verse 6. So that the gospel would be known to everyone, that it would go far beyond Israel, far beyond Samaria, to Ephesus and Colossae and Corinth and Rome. This was God's plan all along. If you have the text still open, look at verse 11 again, right? This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Jesus Christ our Lord. God's plan all along was to bring Jew and Gentile, to bring them together in one church, to bring us today together in one church, regardless of our background, regardless of our history, regardless of whatever beliefs we might have had before we stepped in the door. And this changes everything. It didn't just change everything for them. For anybody who comes to know Christ, it still changes everything for us. Because we share in what Paul is sharing. Right, Dr. Rudelnik has done a great job at unpacking Ephesians so far. And one of the things that he's been saying, right, chapters 1 through 3 describe our wealth in Christ, right? All that is now ours. I mean, just three of the most incredible chapters in the New Testament describing all that is ours in Christ. And this is part of it. We've been given a secret. We've been let in on the secret, right? No more do we have to sit outside it. No. We all know the secret that the gospel is for everyone. And we now know this so that the gospel would go forth to all of those that God wants to draw into his family. Just like with Paul and the apostles, because the gospel has been made known to us, the secret's been revealed to us, we now know what God's plan is. That the gospel isn't just for us or for the members of Harvest on all six campuses, but for those who don't yet know him. So what does this mean for us today, right? We can look at this again and say, well, okay, that was great that God revealed the mystery to them so that they would take the gospel to everyone. What does this really mean for us today? Let's unpack how it affects us, right? Because what we know, this knowledge that we now have, should begin to change the way that we think and change the way that we act and change the way that we live. So let's begin to unpack this plan in greater detail, right? When Paul says the mystery has been revealed, I want to be clear on something. He's not boasting. You read Paul's writing, he never is boasting about himself. He talks about himself as the worst of sinners, right? Here he says multiple times, right? What's happening is because God has given me grace, right? Verse 3, the mystery was made known to me by revelation. The stewardship, verse 2, the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you. Paul's saying, listen, none of this has anything to do with me. What I know, who I am, is because of God's grace in me. And this mystery that I now know was made by revelation. Paul is saying, listen, there's nothing special about me at all. There's absolutely nothing special about me. God didn't reveal this to me because I'm smarter or I'm better looking or I'm more faithful. Again, Paul was a murderer. Paul was hunting down and killing Christians. Paul's acknowledging that. There's absolutely nothing special about me. Paul is basically saying, listen, this whole mystery that Christ has revealed, he revealed it even to me. And that's really our first step in this whole idea, is that Christ reveals the mystery even to me. We can say the same thing that Paul says. I don't know if you sit here every on a Sunday morning, whether this is your first Sunday or 100th Sunday, and just ever wonder, you know, God, could I ever be used like Paul? Could I ever be used by any of the great Christian saints? When you heard that testimony this morning of that young gal at Elgin, did you maybe connect and relate? Like, yeah, I've made too many bad mistakes in the past. But Paul's saying, listen, God revealed it to me simply by grace. Right? He says in verse 8, to me, though I am the very least of the saints, this grace was given. Verse 7 again says, grace was given. So you could say this about everything we've been talking about in Ephesians chapters 1 through 3 to this date. All of this wealth, all of this knowledge, all that we have, Paul is saying, is mine as well as it is yours. Even to me, even to the least of these, right? Paul talks about in these first two chapters, predestination and redemption, being adopted into the family of God. He talks about becoming co-heirs with Christ, being saved by grace alone, having access to the Father. Paul is saying, listen, I'm not worthy of this. It's all done by grace. It's all done by revelation. And that's no different for us today. None of us is worthy. But by God's grace, we have access. By God's grace, we know the secret and we know the gospel. We know the mystery. We are included in his family. Have you ever felt like you don't belong somewhere? You ever felt like, and hopefully it's not the, yeah, that time I was sitting there in jail and I was like, I shouldn't be here. You got the wrong guy. Like, it's hopefully not that. But you ever been somewhere where, like, you're supposed to be there? You have permission, you have privilege, but you just felt like you don't belong. You know, when I was, I'm going to confess to you, it's not sinful confession, it's revelation confession. Get this out before I get here in May, that I'm a lifelong Yankees fan. Go ahead and boo later if you want to. But I lived here long enough, as I told some people earlier, I will root for the Cubs until they play the Yankees in the World Series. And we can fight when that happens. No, we're just kidding. But I grew up in Jersey. I was born in New York. I grew up in Jersey. My first pro ball game was the 77 Yankees. And then they won the World Series. And as an 8-year-old kid, I got sucked into the world. And so growing up watching them, like, again, I don't idolize them. I don't worship them. But being a fan, you know, Yankee Stadium was just cool. It was the house that Ruth built. And when Amy and I, we briefly lived in Connecticut, and my friend who worked for ESPN said, hey, I got two tickets to the game on Saturday. I'd love to take you. We're broadcasting the game. And he knew I was a Yankees fan. I was like, cool, this will be great. This will be fun. We'll probably get some cool seats near the field. I'll get to cheer for Jeter. This will be fun. Well, we get down there. We walk up to the ESPN van. We go inside. He comes out, and he hands me this huge lanyard. It says, all access. I was as giddy as an 8-year-old kid again. Like, what does this really mean? He goes, well, let's just go start. We could get anywhere we wanted to go. I found myself walking through the bowels of the stadium. And you may not know these players, I do, but here comes Bernie Williams, one of the guys that I just love to watch. Here comes Mariano Rivera down the hall. Like, I walk by these guys, and they're like, hey, how you doing? And I'm like, and I see them all coming out of this room, and I get closer to this room, and I'm like, that's the locker room. I can see, like, all the players. And just as we're kind of standing there, two guys come up behind me, and it's Robinson Cano, who is still with the Yankees, and Ron Guidry, who was the guy pitching in 77 when I went to that game. He was there visiting. And the whole time, I'm like, I don't belong here. I'm not like a super fan. I haven't gone to season tickets for 20 years. I don't deserve, we got to go on the field. I got to sit in the dugout. The whole time, I feel like I don't belong here. I don't belong here. I don't know if you ever feel that way about Christ. Maybe I don't, like Jesus, I get the grace thing, but I just don't belong. I don't deserve it. We don't. But just like my friend handed me that pass free, and I got to do that free for the day, Christ says, listen, I choose you, even me, even you. We get to be part of the family of God. We get to know the mystery. We get to share the gospel. We get to be his children. And like the young gal in the video, we get to know his love and be cleansed and healed and walk in his family. I don't know where you are this morning, but I hope at least this first step serves as a reminder that every day we just get to walk and live because God has let us in on his secret. God has revealed his mystery. If you're sitting here as a child of God, he's revealed the mystery to you. I used to tell my congregation in Arizona, listen, every day we should wake up. And the moment your eyes open and you take that breath and you realize you're awake, rejoice. Because as hard as that day might be this side of heaven, I get to live it as a child of God. The gospel, the mystery has been revealed to me. So let's rejoice. But Paul doesn't stop there. The second step, look at verse 6. Let's read about the mystery again. He says this. That's chapter 2. Let me look at chapter 3. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel, right? This mystery that the gospel is for everyone again. The Gentiles are fellow heirs. You know, last Sunday, I don't know if you were here, you saw it online, Dr. Rodelnik, one of his closing lines was this, and it was fantastic. He said, we are reconciled to God that we would be reconciled to each other. See, Paul, before Paul says, hey, this was a mystery, he actually unpacks it in chapter 2. Much of chapter 2 was Paul saying, by the way, the gospel's for the Gentiles. It's supposed to bring us together. It's supposed to reconcile us together. The Christianity isn't a solo sport. It's not just that God revealed it to you, but it's also that, right, he revealed it to us, even to us, but Christ now unites with the mystery that many will become family is what we're getting at. The gospel isn't just meant for salvation, it's also meant for unity. It's meant for the church family to grow over the years and over the decades and over the millennia, that many will become family. In Paul's time, he was saying across racial boundaries and ethnic boundaries, and it's the same today. But it also includes the people that are just simply different, or if we want to use that word, weird. Just keep in mind, when you think somebody else is weird, they probably think the same thing of you. I already know I'm weird, so I'm not offended by it. Right? If you're in the family and you're like, everybody says, oh, every family has that weird uncle. If you don't know who the weird uncle is, just raise your hand. You're the weird uncle, right? But Christ doesn't just reveal the mystery. He doesn't just draw us in and save us by his grace. He unites us, folks. The strongest bond any two humans can share in life is Christ. In fact, Scripture presents very clearly in the New Testament that the bond we share in Christ is stronger than your marital bond. It's stronger than the bond that you share, the blood bond that you might share with your children. It's that strong of a bond that many will become family, even today. What breaks my heart again so often, though, is so much division and disunity in the church. We just avoid somebody because maybe they are different or maybe they're a little bit weird. In fact, I watched in my church, and I talked to many of my pastor friends who've seen this happen in the last year alone. Christians who don't talk to Christians anymore because they disagree over masks or the vaccine. Christians who don't talk to Christians anymore because of who they voted for. Christians who don't talk to Christians anymore because, well, racism is real. No, racism is not real. And all these issues outside of the gospel that we're dividing over and separating over. But yet this is what part of the mystery is, that it's supposed to unite us. Christ isn't a solo, it's not a solo sport, folks. Many will become family. Anyone who Christ draws can become family, no matter how different they might be. Not just in here in reconciliation with each other, but even as we look outside and we contemplate who I might want to share Jesus with. Do we ever put up barriers? That person's too far gone. They're just never going to, that guy is like anti-Christ. I would never even think about trying to talk to them. Why? Paul was anti-Christ initially. And yet God saved him. And we need to remember too, again, look at the language. This isn't my words, guys. This isn't my opinion. This is God's word. Look at your text again with me, right? What happened to the Gentiles? Verse 6, right there. Fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus. And in the Greek, each one of those words has the same prefix. It's the word sin, not S-I-N, but S-Y-N. And that word paints this picture of together. But not just together like we're in the same room, but like an intimate togetherness, knowing and being known, right? So it says we are heirs together. We share the same thing. We're all going to the same place. I've heard it said by pastors often, like if you have a Christian that you really don't get along with here, you realize you're spending eternity with him because we're heirs together. Why don't we fix that now so eternity is a little more pleasant? And I don't know how all that's going to pan out for eternity, but still, folks, right? Chapter 1, verse 13 and 14, we're sealed together by the Holy Spirit, guaranteeing our inheritance. The language there is like that of being engaged. God's saying, listen, you were mine, I've made you mine, here's my Holy Spirit, this is my engagement ring. You can't give it back, I won't take it away. And every child of God has that. Every one of us that is a child of God in here possesses the Spirit, and we are heirs together of eternity because of God. We're going to spend eternity together. And everybody who joins the family of Christ will spend it with us. Right? Galatians unpacks this a little further. Chapter 3, verse 29 says, and if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise, Jew, Gentile, anyone and everyone who comes to Christ. But they're not. We're not just heirs together. We're members together. Right? I love what chapter 4, right? Dr. Rodelnik will, I'm sure, unpack this in the weeks to come, but it says, right, we have one body, one spirit, just as you were called to one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father. This is what we share as members in the family of God. And this membership that we share in the Spirit, this unity that we share, again, is unbreakable. It's a completely unbreakable bond. In fact, the word adoption in chapter 1, being adopted, this is one of my favorite things that I've learned about Scripture, that in the first century, adoption was unbreakable, right? So I have two kids, Jacob and Anna. Let's say that Jacob was a child naturally, he was our natural child, and Anna was our adopted child. If we lived in the first century, we could disown Jake all we wanted. I don't like him anymore. He's misbehaving. He's a jerk. You're out. You get nothing when we die. You can even, in fact, we're taking our name back. You are not part of our family in any way, shape, or form. We could never do that with Anna. Could not do it in first century. God chose that word for a reason. I'm making you part of my family. You cannot get away. I will not let you get away. I will not leave you. Never, ever. We are members together, folks. We are one, and we are also partakers together. There it is again, together, which simply means we share in Christ. It means we share everything in Christ. No one of us has more of Jesus or more of the Holy Spirit than anyone else. Doesn't matter about any kind of schooling or not, or experience or not. We all have the same amount of the Holy Spirit. We all have the same amount of the blessings of God. By His grace, all by His grace. Galatians 3 also says this, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And yet so often we let the wrong things divide us and separate us and keep us from one another. You know, I was on a phone call with the campus pastors this week talking about this passage, and one of them reminded me of a story from years ago. I don't know if you saw on Netflix the Last Dance documentary that came out. about the Bulls. Maybe you did, maybe you didn't. But it was a documentary about the last season of Michael Jordan and the Bulls, their sixth championship. And we were living here at the time, and it was fun to watch and reminisce. And I still remember, they talked about it in the documentary. I still remember being a fan. They had won the first three, then they didn't win for a year or two, and they went after Dennis Rodman. And I remember as a fan, like, hating that guy. Like, he used to take Scotty out. He used to take Michael out. He was dirty, and even Detroit had gotten rid of him, and the team he had been on, he'd basically destroyed that team. They couldn't win with him there. Why in the world would the Bulls get a guy who's unbelievably divisive, who's basically the team's enemy? Why would you do this? Like, to me, that was one of the best modern pictures of Jew and Gentile coming together. Right, Scotty and Michael. Oh! And Dennis? Like, really? Look at this guy. And yet look what they did. Did they become the best of friends? No. Did they become friends? Even in The Last Dance, they talked about each other with affection. They don't hang out. Scotty and Michael do. I don't think they hang out with Dennis much at all. But they still talk about each other with affection. They learn to see beyond differences and say, listen, we're committed to the same goal here, folks. We're after the same thing here, folks. It's no different with the church today. Whoever walks in these doors is an heir with us, is a member with us, is a partaker with us. And we need to look at them the same way that maybe they looked at Rodman, like, hey, if this guy can help, if they're part of the family, if ownership brought him in for a reason, if God has brought somebody into this building for a reason, then we love on them and we embrace them and we accept them and we become family and we act like it with them. You know, we are a family in Christ. I don't know if we always act like it. Like I said, unfortunately, maybe not here. Again, I haven't been here and y'all just seem wonderful. But I've seen too much in the American church, like I said, this division over opinions, over ideas, not over scripture, not over doctrine, but over our opinions and our ideas. Let me just ask this and I'll move on to that last point. Is there someone maybe you need to seek forgiveness from or need to extend it to? Even as you've been listening to this, is there somebody that maybe you've avoided in this room on Sunday mornings and you need to go and seek their forgiveness or extend forgiveness? Or is it just maybe you just avoid them because like I said, they're a little bit different? Or maybe is there somebody outside that you've thought, I'm never going to even try to share Jesus with them. They're just so far gone. Maybe there's some heart sets, some mindsets we need to confess and get right with the Lord. And that's, again, the beauty of grace, folks. Right? Recognizing we're sinners is not about beating us up and, oh, how bad am I? That's the beauty of grace. We're all sinners. We all need that forgiveness. So Christ reveals with the mystery. He unites with the mystery. And let's look at this third step, the last point. Verses 7 through 10, I'm not going to reread them all again for sake of time, but Paul makes very, very clear, right? For him, all of this meant that he was going to be a minister and a preacher of the gospel to foreign lands. He had been to Ephesus. He was now writing a letter back to Ephesus. He had been to Philippi and Colossae and Corinth and Rome and would write these letters. That was his role, so to speak. But some of that does apply to us. Look at verse 10 again. Let's read this one, right? Verse 10 says this, so that, right, God, this is God unveiling his plan, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. God, in his manifold wisdom, might make known his plan. That word manifold paints a picture of like many colored, right? There's so many colors, there's so many facets to God's wisdom, we're not gonna get it all. Not in this life. In fact, we have, Mike and I were talking this morning, reminded we have eternity to get to know God. We're never gonna know it all. Part of the beauty of being a child of God is we get to learn. But in this moment, he revealed some of his manifold, some of his many-colored wisdom, again, that the gospel was for everyone. And he chooses to do that in the church. But here's what's cool. Notice what it says, right? Look at the verse again. His wisdom might be known to who? The rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Angels and demons don't know it all. That's what he's talking about. Angels don't know it all. They don't know everything. And God, through the church, is revealing to them his wisdom, his plan. So when anybody from any race or any tribe or any nation comes to know Christ, it reveals God's wisdom to the world. It reveals God's wisdom to the angels and the demons because they don't know. I just think that's a really cool imagery that God is even using this mystery, not just to teach us, not just to use us, but to also teach those in the heavenly realms. In fact, I like what John Piper said. He reminded me of this. He says, "No angel will ever sing how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. They are not wretches and have never been lost. This is our song and our joy, and they can never sing it or know it. But God wanted them to see it. And so his aim in history is to display the wisdom of his grace in the way that he saves the church by justifying the ungodly from all nations, by faith alone and on the basis of Christ alone." Point being, the church is not done. The church is not done yet, folks. That's what Paul is saying. God is revealing his manifold wisdom to those in the heavenly realms through the church, right? Christ didn't just reveal the mystery. He doesn't just unite in it. But our third step is that Christ provides purpose through the mystery. What the church does matters for eternity, folks. This mystery that Paul is revealing in this moment, 2,000 years later, we know the mystery ourselves. And just like the mystery was revealed to Paul so that the gospel would be preached to all, the mystery has been revealed to us so that we would preach the gospel to all. Doesn't mean we have to go across the oceans and go to foreign lands, but it's where we live and who we are. The gospel does save, it does unite, but it also gives purpose. Like Paul said in verse 2, we are stewards of the gospel today. Right where we live, right where we work, right where we play. And I'll tell you, the more pastors I talk to around the country, the more we see on the news and the media that our town, our state, our nation, and our world need Christ now more than ever. I mean, I talk about some of the subtle divisions that happen within the church. The division outside is even uglier. And Christ, as Dr. Rodelnik has taught us so well, is the only one who can truly unify. Our world and our neighborhoods need Christ now more than ever. Our world is changing. Lost men and women aren't just walking into churches. In fact, we have the first generation of Americans who are being raised in homes by parents who've never set foot in a church. It used to be that, you know, parents, people were kids and they went to church and then they left the church and they got married and now they had kids and thought, man, I got to go back to church because I don't know how to do this. But that's not happening anymore. Church isn't even on their radar. They're not anti-church. They're not against church. They just know nothing about it because they weren't raised with it. Things have changed. And so what we do matters for eternity. Think about our own, and again, like Paul, we're not called to go overseas, but where do you live? What street do you live on? How many houses are there in that neighborhood? Those are our mission fields. We've already been sent. And what we do in those neighborhoods, what we do in our homes matters for eternity. If we go to the gym on a regular basis, we're there not just to work out, but we're there in a mission field, in the coffee shops that we frequent, the grocery stores, and the athletic teams that our children are on. God has placed us somewhere, and what we do there matters for all eternity, folks. Will it get hard? Yes. Will some people not be interested? Yes. But I love what Paul says at the end, right? Where's Paul when he's writing this? He's in prison. And we know from Philippians that Paul is in prison, chained to guards, abounding with joy. And that last verse, look at what he says again with me. He says this, "So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering, which is for your glory." Like, don't worry about me. Ah, sure, I'm suffering. Sure, I'm in prison, but God's using it. Don't worry about me. Right? What did he say in the previous verse? Because of Christ, we have boldness, we have access, we have confidence. So don't worry about me, folks. Just make sure you stay focused on this mystery that's been revealed, that should unite and give us purpose, and that what we do matters for eternity. Folks, this mystery that we've been talking about all morning has been made known so that the gospel would be made known. This mystery changed everything for them. It changes everything for us. Paul and the apostles were recipients of the mystery. If we're here today as a child of God, we're recipients of the mystery. And we have unfettered access to Christ. Every day, rejoice over that, celebrate that, walk in his presence and approach him and spend time with him every single day. We are also united because of the mystery, right? Just like Paul, the Jews and the Gentiles became united today, we are united because of this mystery. So let's look beyond our differences. Let's look beyond our opinions. And let's get to know our brothers and sisters in Christ. Let's not let division separate us. Let's not separate over the wrong things, but unite over the right things. Let's make sure we reconcile where we need to and love and serve where we need to. And just as the mystery gave Paul and the apostles purpose, it gives us purpose. We are stewards of the gospel. We get to make known the gospel. Just stop on that for a second. It's not a have to. We get. Just as somebody once told you that you were a sinner in desperate need of Jesus, and thank God for that person in your life and my life, we get to tell others of their desperate need for Jesus. So let's make sure that, like Paul and the apostles, we also reach out. Amen? Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for my brothers and sisters in this room. I am so excited to join this family. I know Amy and I can't wait to get here. It's a gift even just to be here this morning, to be able to open your word and to be reminded of who you are, provident and sovereign over all things, revealing mysteries when you know it's the right time to reveal mysteries. We thank you for the gospel and the power of it, God. That the gospel saves us. It makes us your children. It allows us to bask in your grace and be forgiven no matter what our pasts are, no matter how horrible we might think they are. We get to bask in your grace, even me and every one of us. God, we cannot praise you enough. We cannot thank you enough that we get to live every day as your child. Thank you for revealing this mystery to us and calling us to you. And God, I pray for anyone maybe who stepped in here this morning, if by chance they've never, much like the young gal in the video, if they've never entrusted their life to you, that they would grab the person they're sitting next to and say, help me to do this, help me to take that step, or they'd find me or find someone afterwards and say, I wanna give my life to Christ today. I wanna know this grace and this mercy and this forgiveness and this purpose. God, let no one leave here today who hasn't yet come to know you as Lord and Savior. And God, thank you for the power of the gospel that it unites. We can be a selfish people, Lord. We can separate over the most idiotic of things at times, our opinions and our ideas, instead of coming together around Christ who saves. None of us is worthy. Remind us of that. We are saved by grace. None of us is worthy. And that alone should unite us like nothing else on the planet, God. Unite us and help us to live like the family that we are, I pray. And God, lastly, I pray too that you have given us a purpose. As a family, you've given us a purpose to influence our towns and our neighborhoods and our streets and our sports fields and our coffee shops and our grocery stores with the gospel. Give us courage. Give us boldness. All we have to do is tell a story. I don't need training. I don't need to know four spiritual. I just need to tell somebody the story of what God has done in my life. I pray that we would live out our eternal purpose, God, and we would have that kind of impact, and we would see in the weeks and the months to come, people begin to flood in these doors because we have gone out and we are loving our neighbor as ourselves, and we are serving them and we are sharing you with them. We're living out the eternal purpose that you have given us. Help us in all of this. And yet, God, I praise you one more time, because you are great and because you are with us every step of the way and because we have access and boldness and courage to come into your presence, and you will give us all that we have, all that we need for all that you are asking us to do. Your grace abounds and we thank you for it. Jesus, we praise you. All of this is possible because of you, in you, through you. So help us to live for you. We ask and we pray in your great name. Amen.